Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Both here at home and abroad, we ask that you bring them home safely to us and watch over them. We pray for our country and our nation as a whole, that you'd be with our leaders both in Washington, here in North Carolina at the state level, and here locally at the local level. We ask that you grant much wisdom to us tonight as we have business here once again to discuss that matters greatly to the citizens of this great community. We ask that you bless us now, and we ask this in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, if we could, let's stand and do.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Eddie. Thank you, Reverend Carter. This time we'll call the meeting, Alamance Board of Commissioners, August 20th meeting to order. Welcome to all of you. We're glad you're here. First item of business is the approval of the agenda, including the consent agenda. I want to, as we review the agenda, note a couple of things about the consent agenda items, the budget amendments from the Health Department. If you look through your... Thank you, Karen. If you look through your amendments from the Health Department, you will see two amendments. On the front page, it identifies the fund numbers. One is a revenue number, 110. One is an expense number, 310, I believe. Craig, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's stop a minute. If you do have your cell phones on, how about turning them off? Thank you. Okay, don't turn them off.
She's cutting it off.
Second page, Barry Bass has identified both of those as account 110, and that is an error on both of the budget amendments. So that is a correction. I don't wish to personally pull it off to consent for that, but that is an inconsistency. The second item on consent, I briefly want to comment on, if it is going to remain on consent, the economic development contract extension. Mr. Honeycutt notes a change in the funding in his cover sheet, but it is not reflected in the actual amendment of the contract. Craig, you said there will be an amendment or an addendum to that annual renewal that will specify the dollar amount of $111,646. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so those items on consent. The other thing I would personally like to do is pull the item of meeting schedule changes from the county manager's report up to past the commissioner's responses. We need to discuss the meeting dates because it could affect the order of some of the other items of business that we'll be looking at tonight. So those are the changes I would like to propose to the agenda tonight. Commissioners, are there other changes or comments to the agenda, including the consent agenda?
I'd like to pull that budget amendment 20 and 21, 3B.
From the Health Department?
Yes.
Okay. We'll pull that out of consent and make that item number. Can we talk about that after the setting of the public hearing for economic development?
Sure.
We'll make that a new item 9. That'll be budget amendments from the Health Department. Commissioners, are there other changes?
Under A, Firefighters Relief Fund Board, is Kevin D'Angelo here? Is he here? I'm just curious. I think I know his father. I don't want to pull it out. I just want to ask.
Okay, so you're okay leaving?
Yeah, fine.
Any other changes to the agenda, including the consent agenda? If not, we'll entertain a motion for the approval of the agenda, including the consent agenda items as discussed and amended. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Eddie, a second. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The agenda is approved. Next item on the agenda is the public comments. Let me say that we have a public comment period for which we have an individual who has signed up who can speak for up to 3 minutes about any subject. We also separately are scheduling a public hearing specifically to talk about the ACC bond referendum. It is not necessary to sign up for public comment if your subject is the ACC bond referendum. If Peter, if that's the case, okay, so you're okay where we are. We will have the public hearing. If you do not sign up for that, that is okay. We'll go around the room for anyone that wants to speak to that when that's on the schedule. So hearing that, is there anyone that wishes to speak about something other than the ACC bond referendum during the public hearing that is not signed up for public comment other than Mr. Childers? Good. In that case, Mr. Childers, we invite you to come forward for the public comment period. Welcome.
Thank you, Commissioners. First, I'd like to request that public comment be before consent agenda. I specifically want to comment on the consent agenda, and it just seems to me it'd be more appropriate to have public comment on that before we go ahead. You go ahead and do that. It probably won't make any difference, but it seems to me a better order of events. I didn't know that the county was paying the economic development fee of over $100,000 to the Chamber of Commerce, more specifically Mac Williams. I'm not sure if we're getting good value for that money, and I don't know what input other citizens and myself would have had on this process prior to tonight. But all I've seen Mr. Williams do is bring introduce companies wanting incentives to this county that have already made up their mind to come to the county and don't need the incentives. And from what I've seen, they're low-wage companies. Frau Foods brings to mind a great example of that. They'd already decided to come to the county, and yet Mr. Williams negotiated an incentive package for them. So. And the other item I have, I'm trying to get into my 3 minutes, is there is a request by Carbro to start dumping their garbage into our landfill, and I would strongly urge commissioners to vote against that if they already haven't decided to do that. Greg Thomas and the rest of the employees at the landfill have done a fantastic job of extending the life of that landfill. And Carbro, and more specifically also Orange County's lack of planning and lack of backbone to do something with their own garbage should not mean that Alamance County needs to shorten the life of its landfill. Given how contentious new landfills are to put into this county, we need to make that landfill last as long as we can. And I just want to say, as I said, the manager there, Greg Thomas, and his staff have done a tremendous job of extending the life of that landfill. So I thank you for allowing me to speak, and hope you vote against Carbro's request.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And I'll just respond briefly. We do have commissioner responses. Greg is here, so you can talk to him directly and thank him for his service, which we would certainly applaud and agree. And Mac Williams is also here. We get from the Chamber of Commerce on an annual basis a report of the activities, and that part of Mr. Williams' role as the economic developer is part of the chamber, whereas other counties, other organizations structure to even have the economic development department as a staff department of the county. So it's a lot of different structures that are out there, but I appreciate your input and your comments. Commissioners, responses at this time?
One thing that Peter did bring up, and I've heard this before, is moving the public comments to prior to the agenda and approval. Is that something we can do? I mean, I don't see where that would, in the future, just to move the public comments up prior to our setting the agenda and our approval of the consent agenda. Maybe have two separate votes. Is that a technicality that will be too hard to do?
Up to this board. How's everybody else feel about that?
Because I've heard before that people had comments and they were actually on the consent agenda items, and I think it'd be only fair to let them be heard before we vote.
I agree. I think that's a good place to move it. Okay.
Everybody okay with that? Mm-hmm. Any objections to that? Why don't we then propose going forward to move it before the approval of both the agenda and the consent agenda. That way we can still address them at the same time.
We need a motion.
Let's go ahead and have a motion.
I'll make the motion that we move public comments to the front of the consent agenda.
Okay, in front of the approval of the agenda.
Right.
Agenda or consent agenda?
Well, I think you're saying both, right?
Not both.
Before the consent agenda and before.
Craig, it will become new item two.
Right, it would be right after the call to order.
Yes. Yes. Tim, you okay with that?
Yeah. You still have commissioner comments at the bottom as well, right?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Peter, thank you. I know Henry has requested that. Is Henry here tonight? I thought, yeah. So, okay, there's a motion, Commissioner Lashley, to move the public comment section prior to the approval of the agenda, which would include the consent agenda, second by Commissioner Boswell. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye. Any opposed? Very good. Thank you. Any other commissioner comments at this time? I'd like for Craig, if you can just take a minute and talk about the schedule changes and why. Let's take them separately. We'll put that under before we go into the motion to call a public hearing, because as I said, it could affect the timing of some of these other events.
Okay. As the board's aware, our next scheduled meeting is scheduled for September 3rd, which we have already changed under our calendar to Tuesday, September 4th, and that's due to Labor Day. However, talking with the chairman, he cannot be here until 8 o'clock that evening because he does teach a class at the community college. There is the possibility, if the board approves, of a public hearing for Project South Park, the economic development project, that would also be at the same night of the city of Burlington. So I think in talking with MAC and to their representatives, they would like to do both public hearings on the same night. So it would work out if the board so chose or not chose to begin our meeting at 8, that they could do their public hearing first in Burlington and then be here by 8 o'clock. But that's just a suggestion at this point.
Well, and let me comment. I do not want to inconvenience the remainder of the board in any way. We have a vice chair that can certainly lead the meeting. I am not going to skip my class, Dr. Nadelman, at Alamance Community College. Classes for me begin tomorrow, and they are on Tuesday nights. So I am okay if you guys want to do this, and I'll just get here about 8 o'clock, and if the meeting's over, that's okay too. It's the pleasure of the four of you.
I'm going to be out of town that particular night and that particular week, so I will not be here either way.
We have a quorum with three?
Yes, sir.
Well?
Well, you're not going to be here. Bill and I are going to be here. I'm going to wait 8 because I sure ain't going to do it.
All right.
Well, I can do it, but I just soon wait till 8 o'clock myself.
All right. Is there a motion from the board for that Tuesday night, September, what's the date, 4th? To begin the meeting at 8 o'clock instead of 7 o'clock, and everything else is as we have it. It's on Tuesday because of Monday because of the Labor Day holiday. Is there such a motion?
And I'll second it.
And I'm going to ask Mr. Lashley to abstain because he's on vacation.
I will abstain.
Okay.
That's why I didn't make the motion.
All right. All in favor of moving the September 4th meeting from 7 o'clock to 8 o'clock. Mac, will that work in your schedule with the folks coming from Burlington City Council to here? Will that, that work? All right. So the meeting will start at 8 instead of 7 on Tuesday, September 4th. Got a motion, a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. We need to also make sure that the media knows, the video folks know.
Right.
Okay. And right. You want to talk about the second one?
We do have a request. Madison Taylor with the Times News request, will you change one of our meetings in October? And that would be either October 1st or 15th, as the candidates form is currently trying to be scheduled at the Paramount. And the only days that they're looking at that they can meet are either the 1st or the 15th. And we do have 5 Mondays in October. So if the board's agreeable, probably the 22nd would be a better option for us.
In other words, not do the 15th, but have it on.
Move it back a week, yes, sir.
So instead of having a meeting and then 2 week break and a meeting with 3 weeks break, we would have a meeting, 3 weeks break, meeting and 2 weeks break.
Yes, sir.
So by the 1st of November, we'd be back the way we were.
Yes, sir.
Any objections to that? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, now let's resume the agenda on item number 6, the public hearing, order authorizing $15 million community college bonds. At this time, I'll entertain a motion that we enter into a public hearing for that purpose and only that purpose.
So moved.
Thank you. Chairman Master, Chair, whatever you are, Linda.
One on your left.
Chairperson Massey.
Previous.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. That's easier. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. This time we'll open the public hearing and invite members of our audience who wish to speak on the specific subject of the community college issuance of $15 million in bonds. We do not have a 3-minute time limit. You're free to speak. So what I would like to do is simply start over here and see who would like to speak, and then we'll end up over here. So anyone on the first row? Second row, Lee, Mark. Third row, fourth row. Barry, you want to speak about this? How about Lynn, your row? Anybody would like to speak on the subject?
I would.
Okay, come forward, please. Introduce yourself to the crowd. And welcome.
The microphone. Of course, I got to touch it then. I'm kidding. My name is Mike Phillips. I own a home off Barber Road about 10 years now. And I've been reading the paper about the confusion between this bond issue and the sales tax. And that's one issue, reason how my basic position is no, don't put it on the ballot. Summarize no. One issue is the confusion of the bond and the tax increase, sales tax increase on the same ballot. And I sort of understand the legal issues. Second reason is my concern is the location of Graham campus. I read in the paper there are several choices the college considered, like the BMOC area, which I think is a better location. I think the population that's served by the vocational programs are in that area, Maple Avenue and Graham. And there's no bus system right now. And to get out to Graham campus is a big issue for some people. They need these programs. So I think the BMOC at least be a better location than the Graham campus for that reason. And people can get down up Maple Avenue or from Graham, you know, in that area. That really needs programs. Not going on to college, need to retrain for a job. The other thing is, I'm concerned about the programs they want to house there. The needs for the programs are mainly from the past. It's like looking through your rearview mirror to drive forward. The machine program, I'm not sure about the real need in this county anymore. Most of the machine shops have moved over to Asia. The big machine shops are over there, as far as I know. Maybe Dr. Nandelin knows more than I do about this. I'd like to see a labor study and demand study on these programs. The HVAC program, I know Mr. Barber personally has serviced my gas pack, and he owns an old mill building on Webb Avenue that's basically unused. The back portion, he has flea market on Saturdays there. Maybe he could rent out, leaves out that program space for the school. He teaches, I think, in the HVAC program. So there would be a lower cost opportunity there. There's a lot of old mill buildings around. But he owns that one off Webb Avenue near Food Line in Glen Raven. The automobile program, great program, but maybe better located on the BMOC campus near the Chrysler dealership and some of the dealerships on Church Street. And let's see what else. I think there is some other programs there. Yeah, one program I don't see on the list, unless I missed it, is a aviation program like GTCC has. I know there's a Honda engine plant now in the county. I'm wondering why there's no program for that. I know the Civil Air Patrol state wing has a building near the airport owned by the state. It's only used on Tuesday nights and one Saturday a month when the state wing meets there. There's a huge office space there. They could set up a program there, at least the teaching part, and get started on an aviation technology program. The GCCC has one near PTI, a new building. I'm not saying you need to build a new building. You see, so Air Patrol, so Air State Building, now used. And the other concern I have is I looked at the Golden Leaf Foundation. It's funded several community colleges to create aviation programs. I wonder if they looked for them for some money, seed money maybe, not the whole amount. And one of this is, I think, a Golden Leaf County. And so my concern is funding there. So I know I'm talking kind of quickly. I'm doing it off the top of my head. But I'm a retired engineer and electrical engineer, and concerned that the future jobs in the county are not in the areas that they propose to put in that building. And I don't think that, and also my concern is that there's no coordination with ABS's new building on North Church Street. It's built this new building up there. Why not build a building up near that campus and leverage off that investment the taxpayers already put in there? And the carpentry program, I think, is also on the list. Doing this off the top of my head. My concern is the building situation in this county. I don't know where it's going to go in the future. I'm not sure that's the best location either for the program on the Graham campus. Again, I'm sure there's plenty of builders in the county can sponsor a location for the program and coordinate with the builders closer and co-locate. Again, I think co-location is a big issue, whether it's automobile, machine shop, the aerospace program, which I don't think is on the list. I think that the board should not put it on the ballot this November. They should ask Dr. Nindlin to come back and talk about the job market for these programs and why it isn't an aviation program like GCCS, and why, what about the coordination with ABSS? So I know I'm talking quickly, but I don't want to see a $15 million bond issued at all right now. I think it's ill-conceived, unneeded right now, bad location, and not looking at external funding sources like Golden Leaf and maybe other funding sources. Other counties have the same problem, transitioning from tobacco and the mill economy is gone, never returned in my view, and we need to look to the future rather than the past. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Phillips. Thank you. Anybody else on that row? Chair? Henry? Welcome to you.
Thank you, Commissioners. My name is Henry Vines, and thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. Mike brought up several good points, and my points are just a little bit different than his. I don't think that the county needs to carry any more debt load right now. I don't think we need to put this bond on the ballot to be voted on. The quarter cent sales tax and the resolution that y'all have in proposing that it be used there. The quarter cent sales tax, you're asking the citizens of this county to approve, is doing two things. Is increasing our debt load and is increasing spending. We're going to use $1.3 million to pay the debt load on this $15 million. Then we're going to use $2.5 million to start new programs and more spending. Commissioners, we just came through one of the toughest budgets processes that we've had. We don't know where we stand right now with this year's budget and how much deficit that we're going to be facing even this year. I certainly think that the quarter cent sales tax is a viable way of raising revenues for this county other than property taxes. But I think we should look at using this toward our financial needs that we're in right now. Our fund balance at its lowest level. We have debt load that's not being met. We're not sure we're even going to meet this year's budget. Commissioners, we don't need any more debt right now. And I think also that we should look toward the future. I don't think that this project is going to be needed as much as a new high school down the road. What, $65-70 million? We're gonna have $95 million worth of debt load. Our fund balance is low. Our bonds is going to be, we're going to drop. Right now we're at average, but as we create more debt, our bond rating is going to go down. So, Commissioners, I would ask that you revisit this tonight think about this, and don't put the citizens in a bind in voting on this. I think that right now is the wrong time to ask the people for more spending and more debt. It's just not the right time. We also, through this budget process, we didn't want to raise property taxes, and we didn't even give the employees a raise because of that. But yet we're willing to ask the people to raise their taxes. Raising taxes is raising taxes, whether it's sales tax or whether it's property tax. And we're willing to do this to build a new building, but we weren't willing to raise one penny on the property tax to give our employees a raise that hadn't had a raise in 3 years. I appreciate y'all's consideration on this, and I really think you need to rethink this thing through a little stronger. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry. Anyone else on the row where Henry is like to speak? About the last row. Reverend Carter, welcome again.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As several of the commissioners are aware, I have the privilege to serve on several boards throughout the community, and I echo what the previous person just said. I hear a lot from local employees that you know, they haven't had a cost of living adjustment or had anything that would boost their morale or help to keep them here throughout our community. I hear that quite a bit. And I know at my own place of employment, if I couldn't pay my power bill or my own employees, and then we sought to add on or build or expand our facility, some might have an issue with that within our membership. And so respectfully, I would say just review this and think of these suggestions that have been given before me tonight. And keep in mind that also the employees that represent various agencies throughout the county are also taxpaying citizens as well. And I believe they deserve to be heard, and respectfully do deserve some type of help in those areas that they have made claims to in the past. I know you can't help everybody every year, but it seems like it's been several years now, and I think some would find it offensive to move forward on this when there's other things that they think are more necessary. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else? Peter?
Yeah, hi, I was really expecting to speak on this tonight, but thank you anyway. I'm generally in favor of investing in education. Certainly what ACC offers is an alternative, a very fundamental alternative to people that don't want to go to college or maybe can't afford to go to college. And certainly the jobs that ACC attempts to train for are necessary for this county. So I look at it as education as an investment, and if you have to do it through debt, then you have to do it through debt, like you have to live in a house and pay your mortgage. We don't have kids. My wife and I don't have children. We never have. But I gladly pay my education taxes. We could have a long discussion here as to what's appropriate for funding education, sales tax, property tax, state income tax, or county income tax, if that could ever be instituted. There's not really time for that this evening. I do think a lot of the comments made prior to myself about the appropriateness of the size of the bond and how the college is going to use this, as was mentioned, I'm assuming there have been conversations between the college and the commissioners on the justification for the size of the bond and what they want to do. And I don't know whether there is a representative from ACC College here this evening or not. Hopefully the president maybe can speak and answer some of these questions here for people. But so I would generally support this. But I would also like somebody from ACC College to maybe answer some of the concerns. That's going to be brought here this evening. I'd like to know more and have those questions answered for myself as well. So I'm generally in support of it, but I'm not going to get into a huge discussion as to how the appropriateness of how to pay for this is. As far as the debt load is going to be paid for, I understand, by the sales tax. So really there is no debt load on the county for this. And so anyway, I'll leave my comments, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Any other speakers? If not, I'll entertain a motion that the public hearing be brought to a close.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Eddie, discussion about closing the public hearing. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The public hearing is now closed. Thank you all for your input. Next item on the agenda does deal with the resolution for the order authorizing $15 million community college bonds, and then separately a resolution calling for a special bond referendum. Just want to take a minute and review why we are where we are. It is confusing, and it will be confusing, and by law, it has to be confusing. There will be two, if this is approved tonight, there will be two separate issues on the ballot that will potentially confuse voters. There will be two separate issues that will appear to some as two separate taxes. And it's not the case. We talked at length with our county attorney, with bond counsel, on what we could and could not say to convey the intent of this board in the presentation of those two items on the ballot in November. And one way we can look at it is we've got a referendum to basically issue the bonds to pay for the center, and then we've got a separate item on how to pay the bonds back. Legally, we can't tie the two on the ballot together. But if the referendum to issue the bonds for the construction of the facility is approved, and the referendum to pay for the facility with sales tax proceeds fails, then the bonds will not be issued. If the sales tax motion on the sales tax issue on the ballot is approved, bond referendum is defeated, then we will have $3.8 million coming into the county coffers that we can decide what to do with, whether it be salaries for county employees, reduction of the property tax rate, funding economic development initiatives, i.e. the creation of jobs. We'll have that flexibility. Obviously, if they both pass, we've got a new center in the stream of income, of which $1.3 million will be used to service the debt. If they both fail, then we don't need to have any other discussions. So it certainly is confusing, and it's going to be, I think, the responsibility of all of us to educate the folks that we talk to on what it is and why it is. And I'll give credit to Clyde Albright and Craig Honeycutt for diligently finding the clearest way of presenting this to the voters of Alamance County. But it's confusing. It is confusing. Now, I will also say, Peter, to your comments about the school's expansion, we have now for at least 18 months, if not longer, been working and in dialogue with the trustees and Dr. Nadelman at the college to educate us, explain to us their rationale. We had them go back to the drawing board, look at other sites, look at other cost estimates at the places you indicated, as well as some others. And it was felt by their board that the location, the plans, the specs that they have presented to us is their first preferred desired outcome. But I'm sure there are a number of people at the college that could present to you the plans and specs, and they're going to need to do that to educate the public as well on exactly what they're doing, why they're doing it, and where they're doing it. And I know Commissioner Sutton had some questions about that recently, about a review of the plans and the specs. All of us toured the facility about a year ago, last May, so almost a year and a half ago, I guess, to review the current programs, and they're overcrowded. I mean, we were looking at plants with gas fumes coming in our, in our right ear. There's no question that it's crowded down there. But that part is part of the educational component that is critical to the successful passage of the bond referendum. But again, if I can try to simplify it and say the two issues on the ballot, one are to issue the bonds, and the second is to pay for the bonds. And you're correct, there's not going to be any additional debt, because if the sales tax revenue is not approved, there's not going to be any bonds issued. And that was made clear through a resolution that we had here, Clyde, at our last, I guess, 2 weeks ago.
That's correct.
When we did that. And that is a resolution that was made unanimously among members of this board. So that's kind of where we are. I've already spoken to a couple of groups and just tried to explain that, and it's not easy to explain. And I don't know how we get around that without breaking the law, which is not something we particularly want to do. Commissioners, any other comments before we actually introduce this resolution? I think it would be appropriate to, if you've got any thoughts, let's talk about it.
Well, and to Mike's comments about locating different places, this, that, and the other, some of these are degree programs, are they not, Dr. Nadelman? All of them are. So you do have to do your math and your English and your other classes also. So then you end up with a transportation problem if you had a separate facility. Is that correct?
That's one of the concerns.
Okay. And to speak to companies coming here, I had talked to one of the people at Sambic a month or so ago at a meeting that we were in together in a committee meeting, and he said when they came here that they had to go back to Michigan, I think it was, to find people that were qualified to run their machinery here in Alamance County, because we don't have the proper equipment at the community college to train them on. In other words, industries have got ahead of us, and I think that really is a lot of what we're trying to do, is catching up to some of the industries that you're setting these facilities up. And I know I'm talking to both of you, but Dr. Nadelman, is it possible for him to comment to some of those questions?
Sure, I would like to.
Would you like to comment to some of them, Dr. Nadelman? I know you've not had a chance to speak tonight, so.
Well, I can just address some of the concerns that were out there. One,
Dr. Nadelman, I'm sorry, but we're being televised, we need you on the mic.
Yeah, I think it'd be good, you know, and maybe address those issues.
So. And welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me talk about Sandvik first, because that's the one you brought
that's
up.
That's who I'm speaking of.
Sandvik needs our machines, absolutely. There's no question. Our latest equipment doesn't meet all their needs, and we know that. The Golden Leaf was brought up. Golden Leaf had money for us for a 4.5-axis machine for machining. We didn't have any room for it. So this new facility would give us the space to be able to put that equipment in. I think it's pretty obvious when you all toured the campus that we're cramped for space. I can tell you for a fact that this fall we had to turn down students in automotive, machining, welding, and heating and air conditioning because we do not have enough space. They're small classrooms. You saw that too. You know, automotive holds 16 students during the day. I can't make the classroom any bigger, and I can't make the lab any bigger without making changes at the college. We can't do that.
Right.
So that's what we're looking for. The jobs are out there. 3 weeks ago, we had three automotive dealerships call us with five jobs, wanting five of our graduates right away. I think we only graduated 9 students this year. So,
and that was because space? Was that a lot of it?
It is. I mean, you know, when you only got 16 in a day program,
right,
they're probably going to go through in a year, or, I mean, 2 years or 2.5 years. Night program's going to take them 3 and 4 years. So, you know, the numbers will increase every third year, something like that. Mm-hmm. We've looked at other properties. You know we have. We've looked at 5 of them. It's not like a classroom. In other words, these aren't just classrooms we're going into. We're talking about space that has specific needs. Automotive, you got lifts. You can't have a one-story building and have lifts in it. It just doesn't work. Most of the buildings we looked at were at least 20 to 25 years old. Even if they have a 50-year life, we're talking about spending 80% of the cost to renovate those facilities for half the lifetime of that building. I don't think that's a good investment. I don't think that's us being good stewards of the county's taxpayer dollars. So we want to try to make sure that we got what we need to be able to move ahead in the future. And I think we're doing it. And I hope the public sees that. I'll be happy to answer any other questions that you feel that were brought up that I could answer.
Also, Dr. Newman, when I saw over there, they don't even have enough room to stick a board up, whatever, I don't know, the size.
In the carpenter class.
In the carpenter class. Yeah. They have to go outdoors to teach carpentry at ACC.
Well.
And I was there to see the auto building, and they're in with the horticulture, and, you know, that just doesn't go either. So, I can see where, and I've been to Alamance Community College. I still go to Alamance Community College. But I can see where they do need space over there. And, because you just like you're talking about the machine, it was so heavy. One of them was so heavy that you talked about it would have went through the floor probably. So I certainly feel like that you certainly do need the space over there.
You know, Sandvik, GKN, they're two big employers. They crave our graduates. And automotive, obviously, is the same way. And I think these are very viable programs. The one having the most difficulty right now is carpentry. And that's not just us, that's the whole economy. Is it gonna come back? We hope so.
It's coming back.
It will eventually.
I got two houses under contract.
You know, think about it, it can't be transported overseas.
Yeah, HVAC can't be transported overseas. You know, your air conditioner goes, they're not gonna fix it in China or India.
Exactly.
Somebody's gotta be here.
All those crafts jobs that's up to be voted on is the crafts people that the industry needs. Machinist and carpenter is something that this country is always going to need. There's a big demand for those crafts.
Well, one of the things I was talking to someone the other day, and if you think about it, and we've talked in the past about data centers coming here, they've got to have very talented HVAC people.
That's
to
right.
Keep their equipment up and running.
And all the industry has to have AC.
So, I mean, there's a lot of aspects to this. In fact, I think it was 2 years ago, y'all brought this to us, and you've been planning this thing for over the last 2 years, and we told you then we wouldn't put it on a ballot in an off year, at least I did, and it's on year, so I'm on.
Well, we're talking about the tax, sales tax increase, economic development, bringing more industry in here, more jobs, we're going to need more trained workers. And I believe that's kind of our role to do that. So
there's always a demand for skilled employees and skilled workers.
Very good.
Are we good for me to sit, sir?
Any other questions for Dr. Nadelman? Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
I want to also recognize and welcome Mr. Carl Steinbecker, who is the chairman of the Board of Trustees for the Community College, who has been in attendance as we've discussed this. Welcome, Carl. The two points that I was thinking as I was hearing the speakers talked about the programs. Why don't we do this program? Why don't we do that program? What I have learned through teaching at the school and this discussion is actually the community colleges do specialize in certain programs, and that's why we see some in-migration from other counties, and that's why we see some of our students go to other counties. You mentioned the aviation program. I think doesn't Guilford Tech have an aviation program, which is 30 minutes away? So trying to tie some of this together, that was one reason I think our board felt that, well, okay, a sales tax might be a good way to approach funding this, because we've got these students coming in from outside the county. They can help pay for it when they go to the shops and go to Tanger and go to Alamance Crossing while they're here in class, and we'll get some of their money, because otherwise we wouldn't, just like our students go to other counties and spend money over there. So that was one rationale, but they do have, surprisingly to me, specialized programs that we don't duplicate among all the neighboring community colleges, and that was an education for me. The second thing is, again, trying to tie together with the prospects of creating a fund for call it economic development infrastructure, I'll call it jobs. In talking to Mac Williams, who is here with the chamber, who heads up our economic development efforts, and I hope, Mac, you don't mind me saying this, but I asked Mac, okay, what are companies really looking for? And the first on the list was a site, a ready site, something that's not going to take 18 to 24 months to get into, but something that we can get into in 90 days to 6 months to 9 months. That's number one. We don't have that. We don't have that because we don't have the funds, discretionary funds, that the county can plow into getting this stuff ready. The second thing was the labor force. Well, that's where the community college comes from, the examples that Dr. Nadelman referred to. So tying the addition of the building that will train the workers to do the jobs that we need on site with the ready land that may be available, I think will help us in the future. And by the way, the third thing Max said then was, okay, after we've done that, then the issue of incentives comes about. So we haven't really been in the game, if you will, as it relates to having the land, the infrastructure improvements available. And that's as much a part of the sales tax initiative as the building itself. And again, that's I don't know what that is, but that's where we are. Other comments? I've got a little bit of a script here, courtesy of our county attorney, but we did have a public hearing this evening. The subject of the public hearing was the order authorizing $15 million in community college bonds. We opened a public hearing. We had four speakers to speak on the question of the validity of the said order and giving us input, issuing of said bonds. We didn't receive, to my knowledge, any written comments prior to tonight's meeting. So we do have the four comments, which we appreciate on record. We did, on the first reading, August 6th, pass the order authorizing $15 million in community college bonds, which created the public hearing that we had this evening, which is now being closed. So where we are now is, following the public hearing, we need to have a vote upon the final passage of the order, which is the order of the authorization of $15 million in community college bonds to be placed on the November ballot. Clyde, is that correct?
That's correct. If you would read the quoted language.
The order authorized.
The quoted language.
Yes.
What page is that on?
So
I thought
page
I was
two,
doing pretty good.
Top page two, the order authorizing $15 million. Community college bonds.
Okay. Oh, the order authorizing. Well, I thought I did that. The order authorizing $15 million community college bonds was read a second time by title and placed upon for its final passage. So is there a motion to pass on second reading the order authorizing $15 million in community college bonds? Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Order the motion made by Commissioners Boswell, second by Commissioner Sutton. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. And unanimous passage of that order. The order authorizing $15 million for community college bonds has been adopted. And we are to direct.
We're authorizing the referendum, aren't we?
Not yes.
That's right. The referendum is right. On the ballot.
That's correct. Coming up next.
That's next. Prior to that, we need to direct the clerk to the Board of Commissioners, Tori, I guess that would be you, to publish the said order in local media. Then the resolution, Peter, this will address what you just said. The following resolution, a copy of which has been made available to all of us, be it resolved that a special bond referendum is hereby called to be held, and it lists the hours of the voting, 6:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m. on Tuesday, November 6th, at which time there shall be submitted to the qualified voters of Alamance County the question stated, which is, bottom of page three, if you're following along, shall the order adopted on August 20th, 2012, authorizing not exceeding $15 million community college bonds, County of Alamance, North Carolina, for the purpose of providing funds with any other available funds for expanding and improving the facilities for the Alamance Community College, including the construction of an additional building and other facilities to provide additional space for classrooms, laboratories, and storage, and the acquisition of any necessary land, equipment, and furnishings, and authorizing the levy of taxes in an amount sufficient to pay the principal of and interest on said bonds be approved. That will be how it appears on the ballot. And again, just as a reminder, our separate resolution was that those funds would be paid from a source as an alternative or from an alternative to property taxes. And in this case, it's the 4% sales tax. So with that said, is there a motion to place that on the ballot?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Linda. Any discussion on that point? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries, again, unanimously. The rest of this resolution simply lists the voting places and has some details on the election, all of which will be publicized. I am going to ask Clyde if that will do it for these items.
It will. And we will publish this on the Alamance News on August 23rd and on August 30th.
Thank you, and thanks to all of you, and thanks to all of you for your input. And I think it's good for the Chair of the Board of Trustees and the College President to hear your concerns and incorporate that in the education piece that must occur between now and Election Day. So thank you. Okay, the next item, Craig, I'm going to ask you to set the stage for setting the public hearing, and then if you'll introduce our economic developer.
We have been working with Mac Williams and the Chamber on a proposed economic development project for Alamance County. The project has been called Project South Park, and it is a $28.6 million project with 286 jobs, or 256 jobs. And Mac is here tonight to make that presentation and to ask for the setting of the public hearing.
Mac, welcome to you.
Thank you very much, Commissioners. Thank you, Greg. Appreciate the introduction. I am excited to be here tonight to ask you folks to set the date for a public hearing for economic development incentives for the project, which has been codenamed South Park. But pursuant to your requirements and the naming of the company that is involved. And tonight, I'm here to announce that the company involved is Sheets Distribution Services, LLC. Sheets being the retailer, the gas and convenience store retailer that is growing in this marketplace. This is not for one of their retail operations. This would be for a facility that would support all of their retail operations, a manufacturing and distribution facility that would be supportive of the current and a lot of the future retail operations. So more will be forthcoming in the advertisement, the required advertisement that must go into the media between now and September 4th. And of course, representatives of the company will be here that evening to state more about their project and to answer any questions that you or the public might have about the project. So at this time, I would request that the meeting, the date of the public hearing be set for your September 4th at now 8 o'clock meeting.
Prior to entertaining a motion, are there commissioner questions for Mac Williams or for Craig about this project?
I just think it's a great project.
Yeah.
Did you say, or did Craig say, how many employees?
250. Actually, it's two. I believe it's 253. Ultimately.
And their local taxable investment is $32.8 million.
Right. Yes. I'm sorry.
That's all right. I can read it.
Off the top of my head.
We'll find it for you, Craig.
I got it right here.
$32.8 million.
The information that we have on those statistics will be given to the media this evening, is that right?
Yes.
Well, as I understand it, the process is now that there will be language in the public advertisement that's required, and there will be details about this in that advertisement, And then there will be information provided the night of the public hearing.
By us
and people from the company, yes. Yes, not from me.
Good.
And we are in the process of, if the board does set the public hearing, of finalizing the agreement this week, and we will try to get you that as soon as possible.
Yes, there is a required written performance agreement that would also be acted on the night of September 4th, and that would be the controlling document between the relationship between the company and the county. And Burlington will be doing the same thing with their situation.
It's nice to get a distribution company here. That's a good way to expand.
It's some manufacturing as well. It's not just simply distribution. It's going to be manufacturing as well.
A lot of jobs.
Thank you, Mac. This is a request to set a public hearing for stated purposes Mr. Williams has outlined. Is there a motion to, in fact, set that public hearing for September 4th at 8 o'clock?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Eddie? A second. Any discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mac.
Craig, before we move on, are you going to get back with Madison Taylor about this other date change?
Yes, sir.
You'll respond.
I can do that this evening if you like.
All right, thank
or,
you.
Or I'll let Chris do it.
Let Chris handle.
Oh, yes. You can do that for us, right?
Okay. Thank you, Chris.
Good. Mr. Lashley had requested that we pull the item originally set for consent on budget amendments for the health department off of consent. I'm going to turn it over to Bill, and Barry Bass is also here as well. So, Bill, let me turn it over to you.
The reason I wanted to pull these is not because of what they are for. Every budget item should not be on a consent agenda. I thought we made that clear years ago. This should not be on the consent agenda. These budget items are too important to be considered on a consent agenda.
We can make sure in the future.
There was a motion. If you go back and look a couple of years ago, we made that a motion.
Okay. Even if it's a grant.
That's right, no matter what it is.
Okay. Do you want to have a threshold bill or just any amount at all?
Any amount.
Okay.
If it's considered a budget, it shouldn't be on a consent.
Okay. And I don't know that we need another vote to that. We can just procedurally make that happen.
Yes, we did.
Okay.
We did do that.
Well, and with that background, are you ready for Barry to then present his budget amendment?
I surely am. All right, sir. In good faith.
Tell us all about it.
Tell you all about it. Right. Actually, you know, we had the reason of having to present this is during the course of our budget. We had found with our agreement addenda that there were some numbers missing, and this came out, and so we've made an inquiry about these two particular funds, and they subsequently came out. That was like in February when we got our initial budget packet from the state. So like in about April, then we got confirmation of the availability of these funds. And we have had these grants over the last couple of years, so they've already been in our budget. And whenever you all had passed the county budget ordinance, these funds were excluded as a matter of omission that we had overlooked putting them in. And so that's on us. And this is during the time you may remember that our fiscal officer had resigned and we were bringing somebody new on. So this kind of fell between the cracks. And so administratively, that was an error on our part. But in terms of these funds have been available the last couple of years, and we're just asking you all to put them back in our budget. They're all state funds. They don't have any local match requirements or anything. So it's operations for these programs.
Questions for Barry? Do we want to examine these separately, or would the board be okay?
We can take them together.
Okay. Is there a motion then to accept these budget amendments for the health department? And these are the ones that the project codes are correct on the summary page. Is that right, Craig and Barry?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Which is the, I assume that the revenue fund is the, or the expenditure fund is 110 and the revenue fund's 310.
Right.
Is that
That's
right?
Correct.
310. Okay. Yeah. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, we'll let Linda second.
All right, Linda.
If there are no questions, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. Now we will go to county manager's report for Town of Carver request and also the response to the offer that the county and I think separately the city of Burlington made to make space available on a scheduled basis for the Social Security Administration staff.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The city manager for Carver has formally asked that the county allow the city to dispose of their municipal solid waste in our landfill. Currently, they have their solid waste that they carry to the Orange County landfill, but that will close, and or they will no longer accept municipal solid waste as of July 1, 2013. Currently, they average about 6,500 tons of MSW waste, and that's mostly from residential customers. And if you look at it compared to what we bring in, this would represent about 8% additional in additional tonnage over what we currently do. If you're looking at revenue off of the $38 per ton, that would be $247,000. However, they are aware and have been informed of the current county policy of not accepting county waste from outside of Alamance County. However, they still wanted to request the exception as a formal approval or disapproval by the board since they are running out of options and out of time. And so we wanted to bring it to give you a formal up or down on their request.
I would like to hear Craig. Can you comment on this, Craig?
Great.
I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I would just like to hear your comments about it.
Do you have other questions? Or,
yeah. I mean, that's my, I'd just like to know what your feelings are. And I mean, is it?
Well, let me.
Yeah, go ahead.
The $247,000, what's that, per year?
That would be the tonnage based upon.
Per year.
Per year, yes, okay. Sir.
Right. Do you have specific questions?
Well, just what is your feelings about it? I mean, do you think it's detrimental to our landfill at any point?
Well, certainly it would use our space that we have available for our residents. Mm-hmm. So I've been approached several times, and in fact, have informed Craig of this, and he and I have discussed this, but it would impact the longevity.
Mm-hmm. Well, we turned Orange down because they wanted at one point to bring
stuff,
you know, theirs here.
And really, it just kind of speaks to, I think, the forward thinking of our leaders in this county, and I'm going back to the early 90s, mm-hmm. and the current board as well. And I know we've got two commissioners here that have been on the board a long time, but, and I'm not implying that you're old, but I know that we have two that has experience and expertise as far as our solid waste ordinance, and our recycling ordinances and things of that nature. So it just kind of speaks to how we plan for where we are now.
Right.
And we may get this request more in the future. It's really a good thing that we've got our landfill, not because of me. I'm kind of in the fourth quarter of my career, but certainly I appreciate what we have as a county. I'm very complimentary of our staff at the landfill. We're doing some neat things at the landfill to further extend the life of our landfill.
And we do have a policy.
We do.
And that's what I'm looking at. If we do for them, then we may have other people saying, well, you did it for them, why not?
Right.
For us?
And I think it's the goals and objectives of the board. I think the board knows that we operate under enterprise funds, so we don't cost the taxpayers anything.
Right.
We're self-supporting. So the additional revenue would just go back into our coffers to further expand on what we do. And I think we already are looking at doing some things with the revenues that we currently have. We can continue to expand on what we do have. We're just very fortunate. And of course, ultimately, this board would make the determination. And I would certainly support anything that this board would direct us to do. And we would wholeheartedly support it, obviously.
Thank you.
So,
And I do want to mention, financially, we're in excellent shape at the landfill. So if the board decides to do this, this would not be do it because we need the revenue or we need the additional tonnage or we've lost the tonnage. We're doing very, very well at the landfill at this point. So if you did it, it would be more of helping a neighbor.
Greg, you said, and Linda said, it's already our policy that we don't do this. Do we even need a formal vote on this?
I think that they sent a letter sent a formal request, and that's the reason why I did put it on the agenda, is, you know, and this will also help us in the future, because this is the second or third request since I've been here, asking to bring in waste, and we have said that, you know, it's been the policy in the past. It may be good one way or the other that we can say, well, they just took a vote on it in August, and so that was the decision in August. So it's kind of good sometimes to revisit the decision to make sure I'm following your wishes.
And the dynamics could change in the future. Randolph right. County is looking at a regional landfill now. Things could happen, such as other counties we could lose trash if a regional landfill were to go in Randolph County, and the private haulers, Republic Waste and Waste Industries, they may find it more financially viable to haul trash to their landfill or another landfill. One of the things that we're fortunate, we have not raised our tipping fees since 2002. Managing space, we're just doing a really, really mm-hmm. good job. I'm complimentary of our staff, and we're very appreciative of the support of the board, and again, the decision making of the board.
Thank you, Greg. And I just add, anybody in here that hasn't had the opportunity to go visit Greg on site and take the tour, it is really an education. Yeah. And I think every
well run.
I think every school group. Well, never mind. I won't overload you.
Yeah,
field trip. School. Every chamber group. Every civic club ought to go out and see exactly what we do here, because that's incredible.
It's
what goes on. And you can't explain it. You've got to see it. You've got to see it.
Yeah.
But
again, I'm so complimentary of our staff.
Well,
landfill.
And the positive thing that Greg's done, and it is over the past few years, we've increased with the compaction, we've increased the lifespan of our landfill as well. So,
exactly. And that actually has changed. Just a few years ago, we were looking at maybe 40 years, whereas now we're looking at potentially 80 years. And I used to hear the term early on of a perpetual landfill. And I used to think, well, that's not possible. But with technology, as it comes on, young people being educated and different things that maybe we don't know about yet, it could very well happen. So in the current group, and I always tell my staff that we're just a small part of a landfill that may be there 100 years. We're just a small snippet. And down the road, there may be other ideas that we haven't thought about. And so we want to preserve it for the next group that comes in.
Do you think, and I think the recyclables help
It's helped tremendously. And we've gone through a transitional period over the last few weeks with Tidewater Fiber Corporation pulling out of our county. And we've received probably hundreds of calls at the landfill. And I think Lisa Alcon, administrative officer, is here tonight. She's fielded so many calls. They pulled out of the county by choice. So we looked at trying to maintain the curbside or roadside collection in unincorporated areas. So we felt like that was so important. So while the cost did go up, we were still able to maintain that. And we feel good about that.
Is there a motion on this issue?
I'm gonna make a motion that we accept it.
Look, Mr. Chairman.
wait, Hugh. Can you elaborate?
Well, if Randolph County is building a landfill and they're going to take trash, and chances are they're going to be taking trash from Alamance County. We're going to, we're going to have to raise our tipping fees if that happens.
Were you on the board when we flew down and looked at that?
Yes, I was.
County. What county was that we flew down?
Sampson County.
Sampson County. Yeah, we flew down and looked at, I think it was it Waste Industries?
Yes, sir.
They were approaching us to turn to basically sell our landfill to them. As far as I was concerned, as a sale. They were going to put $10 million or so on the barrel head, and then they were going to give us another million or so in service fees on an annual basis. And I just calculated it out, and I thought, I'm not selling our landfill for the cost of a school.
Sure.
Or less than what a school would cost. I said no to that. You brought up a point that I was getting ready to ask you about Randolph. Is Randolph still a solid deal? Is that going through?
And again, that's proposed, and I don't know what the status on that is currently. I know that that is their thought process.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't happen overnight. And
no, it's going to take 10 years or 15.
There has to be public hearings. But I think, and it is a good point, if we were to lose X amount of tonnages, then we could maybe alter our permit so as to take an amount that would replace that.
Uh-huh.
So that is a concern. But as Mr. Honeycutt alluded to, we are financially in a position that if we were to lose tonnages today, we wouldn't have to hurriedly make a decision. In other words, we have the monies set aside that would carry us for a period of time. But it's such a good point, because the dynamics again could change, and Randolph County could take trash from everywhere. But we also have to factor in fuel. What's happening now is diesel fuel is $4 a gallon. We all know that.
Uh-huh.
And the trucks that go up and down the roads are getting about 4 to 5 miles a gallon. So they have to think in terms of...
Farborough's awful close.
It is. It's very close. And we could accept Carborough's trash, and we could manage it. So again, that decision was certainly up to this board, and we will support and enforce any decision that this board makes.
What percentage of loss could we, versus what you're bringing in right now, what percentage of loss could we absorb without raising tipping fees exorbitantly? Got any handle on that?
Just off the top of my head, I'm going to speculate maybe 10%. And that's not really putting hard numbers to it, but I'm just on what we take in. We have operational costs that there's no way we can get around it. Our equipment is very, very expensive. Over the life of the landfill, the largest expense is their operations. It's not the purchase of the land. It's day in and day out operations. So we have some of the lowest tipping fees in the area. Orange County's tipping fees currently are $60 a ton. Chatham County is currently 52.
What's there, 38?
Yes, sir. And $2 of that is the state tax. So ours literally is 36. But yeah. But $2 per ton goes back to the state coffers with their infinite wisdom. They implemented a tax about 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. So they take about $170,000 a year of our we pay them.
And if I could also say, if there is a consideration to accept outside county rates, we would need to adjust that outside county rate as well. You'd have an inside county rate and an outside county uh-huh. rate. And we have not looked at that at this point. So, that revenue of $250,000 would be 20% more probably. Mm-hmm. I'm again throwing it off the top of my head.
And with respect to our permit, we would have to go back to the state and address that so as to include additional tonnages.
Uh-huh.
That's certainly doable.
Our contracts with Waste Industry, is there anything in the contracts that locks in that they have to bring it to our landfill?
Not with the commercial. No, there's nothing, because that would be considered flow control.
All right, what about residential?
The residential, when we award our franchises, we do include that in the unincorporated areas. So that's a good question, too.
I think Randolph, if they, first of all, I'm shocked they're doing it, number one. Number two.
Have you heard about that also? Have you, what? About Randolph, the regional land?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I'm shocked that they're even considering it, frankly. And I thought they were more conservative than that, but maybe they need more cash than I thought they needed. But the I think their situation is going to be driven by Guilford more than maybe a loss from us. But no, if we lose it here, you know, it just extends the life of our landfill.
That's correct.
As far as I'm concerned, and I'd rather play that game later. And no, I'm not willing to support any taking garbage from anybody right now, except our own.
We do have a motion on the table to accept the Orange County request that would generate approximately $250,000 a year to Alamance County. Is there a second?
No, $4 million, is that?
Or $250,000.
$250,000.
Yeah. And it would be the Carver request.
Oh, it's just Carver. Town of Carver, thank you, instead of Orange County. And corrected.
So the money would be how much?
Approximately a quarter. Well, again, based off the $38 per ton.
$247,000 is what we got on our sheet right now.
Right. That we haven't looked at any outside rate at this point. And the suggestion that we would have is if the board so chose to allow Carver to do this, is then let us go back and begin looking at with the state about the permit, and then also bring you back a recommendation on tonnage for that for the city of Carver, since it would be an outside the county rate.
If they're currently paying $60 a ton in Orange County,
yeah,
it would not be beneficial to us to accept it for 38, which is our prevailing rate.
That's right. Right. Yeah.
They're literally going to be in a bind.
Okay, well, prior to any discussion further, let's see if there's a second to the motion that Bill Ashley made to accept trash from the town of Carrboro that would roughly amount, based on today's tonnage rate, of $247,000 annually. Is there a second? Motion dies for lack of a second. Is there an alternative motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we formally decline Carrboro's request.
Second.
Any discussion about that motion? We'll call for the question. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Social Security.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I do want to thank Commissioner Boswell for his work on this as well. Eddie has kind of been the liaison working with the other municipalities as well on this. As the board is aware, the Social Security office here in Alamance County closed back in February, and the closest locations are in Reidsville, City of Durham, and also Greensboro. We've been working diligently with the City of Burlington and other elected officials trying to look at options to allow them to come back to Alamance County with a location, even if it was just a satellite on a part-time basis, you know, maybe a once a month, a once a week kind of office. We looked over at the Youth Services Building or the Court Services Building now as an option. And through our discussions with the Social Security Administration, you can see the letter from Andrew Stern. That is not a viable option for them at this time. They had concerns with the secureness of the access for information, that even through a secured internet access, they were still unable to get all the server information that they may have in Greensboro. So that was an issue. The travel time to and from Greensboro or wherever was an issue for them, because they would not be able to add additional staff. So the satellite office that we talked about, you know, both the city's option and our option has been denied. The positive thing is they are willing to do a lot more public outreach at the senior center, at the Cronodal Center, and do some educational discussions, talk about how they can get services over the internet. We can do things as well through our recreation department and providing programs, and we'll try to schedule that. But that's kind of where we're at this point. So I just wanted to give you an update. Again, Eddie, do you have any?
Well, I brought Brian a letter. It really is a shame that Social Security chose Burlington, North Carolina as the only site in the state to close down. We're the only one.
I agree.
Because I wrote a letter to the administration, and their response was Burlington was the only site in this whole state. And I come through Kinston Saturday, and I'm seeing this huge Social Security building, and I'm thinking, you know, this is farmland. What's going on here? And I don't know the reasoning behind that totally. And unfortunately, I've talked to Congressman Coble, and they don't have a lot of influence either, evidently, on that whole administration. So
who's the president?
That's who they were blaming on this, the cuts that the president and them are making.
This was an item for information only. All right, yeah. Let's move on.
Yeah.
I know it kind of went over everybody's head.
I know.
Okay. Do you have anything else, Craig?
No, sir. I do want to remind you of the dinner at Lake McIntosh on Thursday night, the city-county dinner at 6 o'clock, hosted by the city of Burlington.
And we're you're doing the presentation?
We'll be discussing the sales tax and the bond referendum, at kind of giving the municipalities an update.
I'd like to make a motion that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners and receive a report regarding the case of Triumph LLC versus Alamance County, Caswell County, and the Alamance County LME. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Any questions before we call for a motion on going into closed session? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. We'll go over here.